Tell me what you see when you look at me. Do you see another brother lost in these streets looking for his soul?
Trying to find my soul.
Or do you see another brother searching for lost souls in these streets? A street soldier.
Street soldier.
Here to help you get that chip off your shoulder, warm your colder days and sober your drunken ways, and find a way to help you get over these hurdles placed in our path. And this is not meant to amuse you. This is for all those who have questions but are afraid to ask.
Cause I won't be afraid. I won't be afraid. No. When times get hard, you lose your way. Open your mind and hear what I say.
This is a message for the hard and the soft. To those who tune in weekly and to those who keep an eye out for 8 p.m. on Sundays and turn their radios off. The truth hurts. The cloth has been pulled. We're walking around half dead. Use this show as your IV. Alive and free is a new movement. We've achieved self-destruction. A street soldier promotes self-improvement.
Streets couldn't be no colder, so I gotta be a soldier. It shouldn't be this hard for me. Even when it seems so hopeless, I gotta keep my focus. I'm glad to be alive and free, yeah. Streets couldn't be no colder, so I gotta be a soldier. It shouldn't be this hard for me. Even when it seems so hopeless, I gotta keep my focus. I'm glad to be alive and free, yeah.
Tonight is our back-to-school show. We're talking about almost the fundamentals, right? You got to spend 12 years of your life in school. You got to send your kids to school. I think the reason is they wanted Mr. Akins, Lady Estelle, an educated populace. I think that's the reason that school is mandatory. But beyond that, I don't know how much thought that those going through it, I mean, I'm thinking about myself going through it. Did I think about it? Goals and aspirations, what I was getting. I think I put a little thought into it. And we've heard from, Q and Dre. Q has decided to homeschool his, and he has very strong reasons for that. And Mr. Akins talked about his own experiences in school and what he wants for his son. But what I'm impressed about each of them is the thought that they are putting into their own educational experience and what they want for their children. And I'm just thinking about what Q said. When I got to the 10th grade when I was 15 years old, I just got turned off.
I was a freshman, so I was in ninth grade.
Ninth grade.
I got to ninth grade.
Right, high school, ninth grade. Right. Got turned off. But, I mean, you got 4 more years to go, and you're turned off.
Yeah.
Mr. Akins talked about, he was trying to keep his lunch money.
Well, also, I think it depends what kind of classes you are in, too, because I was just, like, in the regular classes. So all the regular kids didn't care about school. But then, like, the ACE or whatever, those kids, you could tell, for the most part, they cared.
Now it's like, funny, when they, and this might not be 100% true, but, I've taught from fifth grade through college. And Leia Stell's been an elementary school teacher her whole life, so she sees them when they come into kindergarten. Miss Akins, primarily middle school, right?
Yes.
But when they come into the kindergarten class, and I've been into the kindergartners, and I've watched the first graders, they are looking forward to, once they get over the fact that, I'm going to leave my mama for a whole day, they're excited.
Yeah.
They revved up. They got all the energy, and they're curious. They're curious as hell. Not structuring that. Is it tough? But when you talk about in the 10th grade, 9th grade, they didn't care. Something happens between then, and that I don't care. I didn't care.
Yeah. And for the most part, I still have the same group of friends since I was like in 5th grade.
Yeah.
And when we were young, we would like compete, like who could get the better grade or who could try to finish their homework faster.
Mm.
And then as we got older, it's like, Isaiah stopped caring. Renee stopped caring. people just stopped caring.
All right, let's get some thoughts. So we're going to ask you, and you're calling about your own educational experience. We're going to ask you, what do you think, what should folks get out of school? Have you thought about it? I mean, what makes a good school? It's something you got to do for 12 years, all of us. And there's a lot of repair work going on because maybe, I guess, it hasn't been done right. Okay, let's go to line one and let's talk to Jan. Jan, hi. Yeah. You're live on Free Radio, Street Soldiers. How are you? Thanks for calling. It's our back-to-school show.
I'm doing good. Q, I really feel what you say, like, about Kennedy High School. I'm actually from SAC.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I mean, be more specific, I went to Franklin, but that whole education system was way different than Kennedy. Mm-hmm. But I just had to put a side note. I tweeted you guys over through KML, like, SAC, it's known for just government and education, and it turns out that education system isn't that, you know, that great. But that's what runs Sacramento. That's what gets the funds in. Mm. My opinion on school in general.
Yeah. So
homeschool, anything, it doesn't matter. It's really how you enlighten your kids. It's really how you support them. That's really what matters. I grew up with a Fah family that didn't know what the hell they were doing in America. And basically, they're just like, go to school, do this, do that, whatever. The entire time I was in college going through high school, you're like discovering yourself. And that's what you should really be encouraging your kids. Mm-hmm. Education, the school system is there to discipline you. It's just to get your kids used to waking up, keep you, and for you to go to work. And basically, college, you really got to be, like, if you want to send your kids to college, really just send them because of the network and what you can do with that. And it's really, like, as long as you have a paper, you have a degree, that doesn't really matter. Because once you get in the industry, you get your experience. That's all that matters. So you pay for the experience, but you're paying for school. Network, and that's all I have to say. Like,
hang on, because I like what you have to say. Let's take the college piece out, because that's voluntary, right?
All right.
You don't have to look out. But the K through 12, absolutely, you got to go, or else you're going to get a fine, or you might get thrown in jail. And there's a lot of statistics. Go ahead.
Yeah, so, like, what I have to say for high school, like, honestly, like, it's a trip, because you could send your kids, you don't know what they're going, you know, and you don't know what they're going to be influenced with, the teachers and people. Like, there's a lot of people in that system, depending on what district you are. There's teachers that will not, they don't care. Mm. And, like, I had a good opportunity with, like, a lot of good teachers, and I was lucky, but, you know, I was in the honors classes. That makes such a huge difference. I was in the streets. People didn't think I was in honors classes, but I was, like, people were like, wow, like, what are you doing here? But the education, the quality, and the time, and, like, they care about is, like, wow, if you put your kids in honors, like, you put them into, I don't know about private schools. Like, private schools, that's a whole different topic. But I'm just saying, if you put them in higher elevated classrooms, like, that really does make a huge difference. It gets them to really start thinking analytically, and they challenge you more. But
So what, like, do you think folks should get out of the experience, I guess? I guess what I'm looking for, and I know what I got out of it, what I didn't get out of it. What do you think people, yourself, or anybody, any young person, should get out of the experience? I heard you say analytical skills. I'm assuming you're making...
Sending the kids to high school?
Well, just the school period. 12 years. They got to go 12 years.
Well, first of all, y'all going to learn your math. You guys need to add, subtract. There's still some adults that I'm like, come on, guys. Like, let's do this. Like, you know, you just need to get your basics. But pretty much, it's really just self-discovery for that child.
Self-discovery. Okay.
I mean, like, yeah, self-discovery. Like, right. That's really it, okay? Because by the time you go, you send them to college, like, that's on them. But it's self-discovery. It's, like, really, like, learning habits of just being a person, right? You know, mm-hmm. being a genuine person, or being someone that, you know, people want to be driven by or be around. It's, like, it's building character. It's building that character that time. And it's like, you know, when you give birth to a kid, you're like, hey, you know, I got goals. I see this kid becoming something. But, you know, sometimes they get influenced by, like, you know, the social
norms.
So
I'm going to ask you, because I got a bunch of folks. Do you feel that you left the 12th grade with a sense of self-discovery and character?
I didn't have a beautiful upbringing, but, you know, I felt like I had more ground and knew who I was going into college, and I was ready. Like everybody else, I just feel like they're just, like, clueless. But I was just, like, ready. And, like, I think that was what I, like, despite, like, my upbringing, that's what I was so glad that I just went through high school. Like, self-discovery, knowing what I like, knowing my strengths, knowing my weaknesses, and knowing what I need to,
now,
like.
Do you think that was due to the teachers,
You know what? I had one professor. I'm going to tell you, if you have a kid in the trouble, or you don't know it, if they are able to find a mentor through high school, man, tell them to build that. Because even if you can't do that as a parent, they need to have someone, you know. If you can't do that as a parent, because sometimes you can have a kid and you don't have that connection with that kid. But if that kid can make a healthy connection with an adult and they can learn and they can grow from that, then word, like, that's what they need.
9-3, Kimberly, school, yes, education, hello. What's it all about?
Oh, my God.
What well, should it be?
Well, I think it should be a lot more better than what we had as kids growing up, but it doesn't seem like that's what's really going on nowadays, because I got two teenagers in high school, and it's really sad how they take away a lot of the extracurricular activities that are for the school system so our kids can learn, like, life skills. If their parents are working two jobs, who else is raising our kids? And you want the best for that. And my kids go to McClyman's, which is in West Oakland.
No Mac and, well.
yeah, it's supposed to be the Mac way, but whoever's running the Mac way isn't the right way. I'm going to tell you that right now, because I talked to a lot of people that used to go to that school, and they say it's not like how it used to be, which should have been a whole lot different than what's going on now.
What do you want your kids to get out of this? What do you want them to leave that school?
I want my kids to learn, you know, what's best for them. You know, what they like to do, what they want to do, what comes out of going to school is life skills. And the thing is that it seems like my kids are coming home. Why do I gotta go to school when I'm not learning nothing? And I'm like,
wait. They say, why do I gotta school? Why do I go to school when I'm not learning anything?
Yes, because a lot of the teachers are like, if some of the kids are I remember going to school. We never maybe we had a couple of class clowns, but man, it seems like all the kids in the class, and they don't have enough, like, structure, I guess. I don't know. It's crazy me living out here and seeing my kids come home and tell me what goes on in their day, and I feel really hurt. And I go to school all the time, but you know what? It seems like they're always blaming this person, blaming, and then they go and blame the kids. And I'm like, hold on a minute. Who's supposed to be the adult out here running things and trying to make, you know, an actual understanding of what our teenagers are going through, man?
Wow.
It's really, really sad. Living in West Oakland, a lot of our kids are lost. I don't know what's going on with the parenting, I told the school, you know what, if my kids are doing something wrong, you need to contact me. If you don't contact me, how am I supposed to nip it in the butt?
Wow.
But they don't seem like, I walk down the school.
Okay, I'm going to do something. I'm not going to take away from the school experience, but I'm going to add to it. Mm-hmm. Take this number that you called tonight, dial it tomorrow, find out the additional program that we run at Alive and Free Omega Boys Club to help your young, how old are they?
I have two. I got a 15 and a 16-year-old. Okay. I got teenage girls.
Okay. All right. Get to where you want them to be. Based on what I've heard, I think we can help with that.
Oh, that'll be wonderful.
Won't cost you a dime.
You know what? For
because
me,
we
I
want
my
the
butt
same
off.
Thing. We want. I mean, I'm listening. Lady Stell's listening. But Ms. Dagan's listening. We want to help with that.
Okay. Yeah, we work our butts off to try to make the most of what our kids growing up and stuff. And it seems like nowadays we work our butts off, and it seems like it's
let me tell you what I can guarantee you that thing you talking about, adults and structure and all of that will definitely be there. If that's a concern for you, we can take that away.
Okay.
You sound really skeptical, like, really?
No, you know what? I've been to the school on and off, and it seems like they're just like, oh, you got to talk to this person. I talked to more than a handful of people.
So what we're talking about the Leadership Academy at the Alive and Free Omega Boys Club. And so, yeah, Tuesday night at 1060 Tennessee Street, 5:30, bring your kids.
Did you personally get a good one? But I want to even go further than that. I want to, what should, we have to go to school for 12 years, although a lot of people drop out, so, you know. But what should happen in those 12 years? I mean, you know, and I probably want to look at you and then, you know, go to Dre, because, you know, when you send your kids to school, what should that experience be? What do you want them to get out of it? I mean, are you doing? I know you're doing it because you have to, and in some cases you'll get fined or something will happen to you if you don't send your kids to school. But what do you want that experience to be for them? I don't know if people even think about that. Is this something? And my kids turn 6, I register them, and they got to go. And then looking back on it, what did you get out of it? Was it good for you? Do you think you got a great education? What did you think you missed? And so on. So what did you think you missed? And so this is a huge, it's something that just goes on all over America, all over the world, that we send our kids to school. And I don't know that we, I got to ask you, you're taking the, what one would call the radical approach. You've decided homeschool your child.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Why?
It's just what me and Grace, we feel like that's best.
Right, why do you feel like that's best?
Just because, I mean, up until I could, like, really afford, like, a good private school, we feel like we could educate him better.
Than he would get in the public school.
Yeah, public school.
Why do you feel that?
Well, I guess my experience, I mean, when I was younger, like, when I was in Dixon, I had a good school experience. But when I went to Sacramento, like, I remember I had a teacher named Miss Kenny.
What age?
And I was like 15.
15. So you're in high school.
I was a freshman.
You're a freshman in high school. Okay.
And I had moved from Dixon to Sacramento.
Uh-huh.
And just the teachers were, it was a mess. Like, it was a mess.
When you say a mess.
Yeah.
And then you're still looking at you like, boy, what do you mean by a mess? What was a mess about it?
I mean, just the classes were like, I mean, and I lived in a pretty, I actually lived in a good area. It was like South Sacramento, Greenhaven, and Pocket.
Right.
Went to Kennedy. And, it was just like, you know, it was compared to Dixon, it was a lot more rowdy. My teacher didn't speak English. I mean, no, she didn't. She did speak English, but I don't know. I couldn't really comprehend everything she was saying.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of kids felt that way. And they were switching teachers like in the middle of the year and stuff like
that. See, that's the kind of stuff I want to know. So you had different teachers during the year for the same class?
Yeah, for the same class.
Even then, at the age of 15, did you feel like you were getting cheated?
No, well, once I moved to Sacramento, I felt like I kind of just like gave up on school. I mean, I would do the minimum.
Yeah.
But when I was in Dixon, I was an honor roll student. Like, I still have like, you know, stacks of like just awards and stuff like that. But once I got to Sacramento, I mean, I was away from my friends and I just didn't like it.
Did the experience turn you off to education?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
See, and that saying that right there is, there's nothing more can be said. I mean, it turned you off.
Yeah.
And I don't know, did you drop out of school? You just kept going and so on and so forth?
I mean, I kept going. But yeah.
Well, a lot of people drop out. Yeah. That's why I'm saying it.
Yeah.
But it turned you off so much that here you are now with your own child years later who isn't yet to 15 years old and yet to the 10th grade, that you're like, no, I don't even want to.
Well, it's not just that. It's just also the influences and stuff, like the people.
Uh-huh.
Like, yeah. I mean, I have pretty strong beliefs and I don't want to. I mean, I want him to be exposed to everything, but I want to, you know, prepare him before we just send him out.
I guess what I like about this is that you are taking your son's education seriously.
Yeah.
And you're thinking about it. Yeah. And part of that thinking has to do with your own experiences. Mm-hmm. And part of the thinking is the experiences you want for your son.
Yeah.
I don't know that a lot of people think that seriously about at all.
Yeah, well, you see, that's why, you know, I'm trying to basically raise capital in this business so I could take him to Egypt and, like, show him the historic sites and stuff like that.
Okay.
I'm not just trying to, like, just look at it in a book. That's cool too, but I want to actually travel and do all that. So that's the goal. Yeah.
I'm just impressed. No, I'm impressed that you're thinking about it. And I don't know if all parents think like that when they're 2, 3, 4, 5. that, Mr. Akins, we have a long history in education. And I'm wondering if, what just, we'll go to you. You got a couple boys who are getting ready to jump into that. And you know, do you think people actually think about that? Like the way Q is thinking about it?
I think some, but I don't think that is norm. Mm. And I think based on their experiences shape how they see and how they value education.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people have had horrible experiences, whether it's been because of whether it had to deal with the social aspect of school,
mm-hmm.
whether it had to do with the academic or just the interaction between student and adults after school. You could kind of come to a determination that this S ain't for me and that these people don't care.
Mm.
Because a lot of times you go into school and you don't even know why you're going to school.
Now you're hitting on the kind of things I want to get into.
When they have their assemblies at the beginning of the year, you get the rules of what you do and what you don't do and what's going to happen to you if you don't. But there is no real motivation in terms of why you need to develop this thing that we call an education so that you can be a viable part of society. And keeping in mind, knowing that it is not perfect, but it's the only thing that we got. So you need to have this thing. So whenever you figure out what you're going, what direction you're going to go in, you have these skill sets that you can call upon and then move throughout society, make choices, make decisions based on that.
Yeah. Also, I just want to say, I mean, I know this is, you know, pro-education and stuff like that, and I am pro-education, but I'm just saying, I know a lot of people mm-hmm. who are just way more set than the people who have gone to school. And mm-hmm. that's, yeah.
Well, yeah. So, and that's the question is, what do you want to get out of education? Yeah. And what do you, well, it starts with, number one, when your parents take you to kindergarten, take you to first grade, mm-hmm. it ain't about what you want. It's about what they want, right?
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, does any thought go into that? Will they do it because, you know, I got it's time for you to go to school? And clearly you have an idea, some idea about what you want your child to get out of that process.
Yeah.
A lot of times I talk to parents and they say, I want them to graduate. Okay, but he's been there for 12 years. Is there anything else other than want him to graduate? Now, graduation is significant. I will say that. There's a lot of studies linked with high school graduation and, what, prison and all kinds of stuff, right? I mean, you know, earning power and all of that, so on and so forth. So I get that, but I don't even think there's so much thinking about that. I think, you know, I don't know if they've given any real thought. And I don't – but I just – Yeah. Now, we you know, Ms. Higgins, did you think you got a good education? And did you give any thought when you were coming through, let's go K through 12, we're not leaving, we even college out, because college is voluntary. It's not mandatory.
Man, I was just trying to figure out how I was going to keep my lunch money. You know, it was... And it's funny.
It ain't funny, but...
No, what I mean by it's funny because in elementary, you know, I was on the accelerated track and gifted student. When I got to junior high school, it all changed. And so where I had all these high test scores, I was completely functional in the classroom and doing everything that was asked of me and then some, and wanting to do that, there was just something wrong with being a good student socially at the school.
Mm.
And then it didn't help that there were very few adults who were coming forth to try to say, hey, you have some problems going on, let me work with you. Feel comfortable and coming to talk to me and dealing with these other things, because if you're not in a climate conducive for you to learn, you're not going to learn. And part of that is feeling safe. Part of that is feeling like you belong. Part of that is feeling that the people around you are interested in you, and I mean adults. So when I was getting beat up, I had adults looking at me and closing their door, you know, so in my mind, my day was figuring how I was going to keep this from happening versus I wonder if I'm going to do well on this test or if where can I go to get this information for this paper that I need done or who can I talk to help me better understand my math? None of those questions were in my reality at the time at going from K through 12. I would say K through 6 was fine. It all went downhill starting at junior high in the 7th grade.
Which I know about. What do you want for Andre?
First.
As he's going through this K through 12 thing, what do you want for him?
First, I want him to just be a kid. Uh-huh. I don't want him to worry about protection or feeling awkward or feeling whether or not somebody's going to come to his rescue and getting in his mind. He knows he could call me, and whatever issues that's going on, they're going to be solved. So he don't have to worry about that. Mm. Secondly, I don't want him to feel that he have to, and I'm just use this term, dumb down to be accepted by anybody. I want him to be proud to be an intelligent young man who is enthusiastic about getting his education, whether he want to go to college or not. And he says he does at this point. Mm. But my issue is to make sure that he has the basic skills to be functional in this society. And if he want to go to work right after he finish high school, he can go to work and do that. If he wants some kind of specific training, he have that base skill sets available to him to let him go through. The other thing that I'm working with him on currently is developing the character of the type of person that he needs to be for himself. Mm. And the way school is, and Q, I think what you were hitting on, is within the social aspect of what school and how they go about socialize, so many young people get caught up in losing their identity and attaching it to other people, other things, and getting involved in this or getting a whole. You want to try to control that to as much as you can as a parent so that they don't get caught up in all this other stuff. But at the same time, it is a process that they need to go through. You just have to know how to manage it correctly. The consequences of him not getting it right are multiplied by 100 for him than it was for me. Although I had to deal with some stuff, this is a different day and age. I mean, I have to tell him specifically right now, you know, what to be ready for when in those conversations when that wasn't necessary.
Continuing our discussion on Alive and Free Radio, Street Soldiers, about schools. Our Back to School show. Everybody's back to school. But back to school to what? To what? 12 years, you got to go. What'd you get out of it? Was it good for you? You know, what are you supposed to get out of it? You're going through the motions. I mean, you know, you go from what roughly the age of 5, if you start with kindergarten, to the age of 18. That's 13 years of your life. We had some great calls. One caller talked about self-discovery and character is what you should get out of it. Ms. Dakins talked about he wants his son to have the basic skills to function in this society. I'm looking back at my own education. Honestly, I got a great one. I really did. And I think the reason, and you know, is that from the time I went to school to the time I graduated from 12th grade, that the folks there had high expectations for me, mm-hmm. and I couldn't get away with not doing my best. Yeah. And I will say I went to private Catholic schools, you know, my whole life, yeah. and they were like, I wasn't doing it. If you couldn't do it, they wasn't going to pass you. Mm-hmm. That was it. Yeah. You know, I could have been, I love saying that. I could have been 18 in the third grade. It was fine with them. You know, So, you know, I and they just like, no, you're going to do it. The expectations were high. The thing I missed and I say this, you know, all the time, was I learned nothing. They didn't think me learning about my history and my culture was important. It wasn't on their landscape. Yeah. And that was the big glaring hole in my education, which I had to learn on my own. And if I had to, I had to, you know, put it all over again, I would make that a part of. And that was just a hole in my soul. Mm-hmm. But they never saw that. They did not see the importance in that. So in a way, it was great, but it was a huge missing part that I had to fill in, which helped make me the person, you know, I am today. So I, of course, with that resonated with the caller before, like it was Mary calling in, resonated with me. When I became a public school teacher, I'm telling you, I went from, what was it was like when you was addicted to when you went to the other school?
Yeah.
I went from structure to the zoo. I mean, it was like, I was like, and the biggest difference was just the expectations. I mean, it was like, I couldn't believe it. I was like, and I was gung-ho and fired up and loved it. And it was just, you know, we got a lot of calls. I want to get to them. I just had to say it about my own. We'll get to Lady Estelle's and her own personal education. What happened? She left? You better call back. Who was that, Carmina? Carmina, I know you got something good to say. Give us a call, 800-765-3437. We're talking about education. Let's go to line one, talk to Carrie. Carrie, go right ahead. You're on.
Excuse me, hello?
Yes, you are on. What are you, your thoughts about education, okay. Educational system, your own personal experiences? You got kids, the whole bit. Go ahead.
Well, I'm going to give a full circle. My mother has her master's in education. Mm. She's a behavioral therapist.
Mm.
I went to a Montessori. My mom has taught in Ethiopia. She's directed schools. She still does behavioral therapy.
Mm.
For me, mm-hmm. I'm a black woman. I have two children. My stepson goes to private school. He's been going to private Catholic school since third grade. My daughter goes to a Montessori, which costs us $2,000 a month to send her there. And even though she is getting an exemplary education, and it's really interesting because they're teaching her, it's so outside of what we see in the normal classroom of
right.
a formal education, but she's the only black child.
Mm-hmm.
And I hate to have to be so aware of it, but at the same time, I also went to a Montessori, and my parents did the same thing, and I was the only black child once again. And what my parents did is I had to have a whole secondary education of being black.
I got that.
School.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but for me, actually, education isn't like it doesn't. It's not so black and white in terms of it's not that simple. Because my mom's a behavioral therapist, I understand how important it is inclusion to have everyone in the same classroom. How we have classrooms now where if you're blind or you have a some sort, any type of disability, we separate the kids.
That's true.
And so for me, how I look at that is that it teaches us as human beings, it dehumanizes us. Mm. It makes us think, oh, this person with a disability, instead of learning from a young age how to help someone who's blind, mm. we learn that they're so different that they need to be placed somewhere else.
Mm.
So we subconsciously are teaching ourselves how to be, basically how to isolate ourselves based on something as simple as a disability. Everybody has some sort of disability and needs help. So for me, formal education, I would just like it to be more inclusive.
I just
would like everyone to be able to get to be in the same classroom. And for and with black people, I think it goes much deeper than just education because our problems are deeply rooted within the entire system of this country. So a school is not going to be the only thing that changes it, but it is a fundamental change that needs to be made around all cultures, though, period, and people of different lifestyles.
And you believe that education, it sounds like you believe that education can play a big part in doing that.
I believe in education. I think it's very important. I know everybody learns differently. I just would like to see it be more inclusive. I just would like to see it be more for what they say it is about. Because right now we're just teaching people how to get a job, not how to be innovative, not how to help other people, not how to create something new, not how to go against the grain. So I get worried about those things. That's the only thing that concerns me.
Well, I'll add something to this. I've seen schools that don't even want to teach you how to learn. They just want to see you how to graduate.
All right. Well, that's...
No, I mean, I'm telling you, I have seen schools that the whole thing is a graduation rate. Not what you've learned, not what skills you leave it with. You know, just your hour, they can say that they have a high graduation rate, which I think is sabotage. Can I use that word? I think they're setting up for complete failure because I believe when you go out into that world, there's a set of skills that you have to have. And, you know, for those folks, for their biggest thing is, you know, I'm trying not to say the name of the school, but, you know, that I think that is the worst thing they can do for a young person. I mean, look, face it, I'm being tough with this. There are a lot of schools that just want to wash their hands of the, you know, you're off my rolls now, which is terrible to say. But I've been this, Mr. Akins would agree, and Lady Estelle would agree, we see this. But I really like what you had to say at Montessori schools. I like, in fact, it's three generations now. That's great. Great for, good for you, and the positive things you had to say about it. Okay. Oh, she's gone?
Yeah, she dropped.
Oh, okay. Lady Estelle, yeah, man, I'm going to give you a chance. Anything you want to add so far? We got a bunch of calls, but we'll take them. Or chime in, or want to keep moving?
I have any more to add. I mean, I think that my education was good. I went from a mixed school, but then that was a long time ago. Standards were different. Expectations were different. And
but should they be different?
No.
Okay. That's all I want to say.
I don't think so.
No.
Anyway, expectations were different. Things were different. I went to school knowing, you know, almost how to read when I started kindergarten.
Mm.
But where I was, they didn't expect me to know what I knew. It was kind of funny. I had an attitude in first grade. I went to a mixed school in the beginning, and then I went to an all-black middle school.
Mm.
And I tell you what, those teachers scared the crap out of me.
We're on the radio. You might have said something else.
No. You were going to learn something, and you were not leaving here until you got it.
Mm.
And so, you know, that was great. That was horrible and great. But you know,
horrible and great.
Oh yeah, I mean, they were not playing. And then they rezoned. It's so funny because as the African Americans increased the knowledge and the test scores, they rezoned. School district would rezone, you know, and then everybody could get to come to the black schools. It was really kind of funny. And so then I ended up at another mixed school, which was really good, boring, but really a good school. So I think my education was good.
Great. You said a lot has changed, and that to me is sad to hear. Because if it produced you, it shouldn't have changed. Well, nothing should change.
Thank you, though.
Line 4 and talk to D. Thanks for calling. What you got to add to this? Go right ahead.
Hi, I am calling because I am a recruiter, and so I'm talking to people all the time who are looking for jobs, applying for jobs. I'm talking to employers who are looking to hire people, and it's just interesting to me how the education system has failed us.
Mm.
But we've also failed ourselves.
Mm.
And parents are failing because they're allowing their kids to make excuses.
Mm.
They're talking about what the teachers aren't doing, what the school isn't doing, and we're not holding our kids to a high enough standard.
Mm-hmm.
And when they come into the workforce, they're bringing these excuses, and nobody cares at work. When you're interviewing, nobody cares why. They just want to know, can you get it done? And so there's a lot of language about why, telling the background story. And we just allow that so much. And the schools are setting them up for that as well, where they take a lot of excuses.
You know, you're a recruiter, which means they come to you. What do you see when they get to you? Do you see an unprepared person? And if you do, in what ways do you, what do you see?
Well, I see a lot of different things. So, like, when I look at entry-level roles that I've hired for, I see a lot of people who are unprepared. They come in, I hate to use this language, but it's like they come into the interview speaking jive. and it's like,
I know what you mean.
It's not English. Is what it is not English. That's right.
Not English. And so, and you know, I'm of color, so at least I try as much as I can in my environment to kind of coach them a little bit more and be like, hey, you got to pull it up a notch. And then the other thing that I see is in a lot of cases, I see people who are really trying, but they just don't know any different and they don't know any better. And so people who you may connect with as a recruiter, and I really want them to succeed, they still are not able to make themselves marketable enough so a hiring manager can see the benefit. Like, why should I hire you? What can you do for me? In an interview, I don't want to hear you tell me, I'm just trying to feed my kids. That's not what a hiring manager wants to hear.
That's right.
I'm trying to pull myself together and get off these streets.
Yep.
Not what a hiring manager wants to hear. That's not, there's nothing in that for them. So you have to be able to switch it to what's in it for you. What's in it for that manager? How is it a benefit for them? And so those are things that I see. And I think it all comes with, I think the schools just allow students to be mediocre and they push them through and they think mediocre is okay. And, you know, I heard some callers call in and say, education isn't for everyone, but it is. Whether or not it's a formal education through college, or you have to have some type of education. You have to know something. You cannot survive in this world if you don't know something. Even if it's entrepreneurship, even if you want to do your own thing, you still have to know how to do it. And so education is for everyone. You should always be learning.
Let me say this. We, and the three of us, this is our whole life, right? And I can't tell you the number of times that we have been in front of young people. And I will say high school seniors, right? And they are like getting ready to graduate. And they will say, I said, what do you want? I want to get a job. I want a job. I want to get a job. And we will look at them and collectively say, ain't nobody going to give you a job.
Right.
There's no way you're going to, man. What makes you think you're going to get a job, right? And somehow you can clearly see, just, and you've said it, just some of the things that they're sorely lacking. And then they get mad because nobody wants to give them, you know, job. Nobody wants to give me a chance. And some of the things you said, I think better than anybody could have said. Because forget going to college. Forget all that. Forget, you're a recruiter. You're looking for folks. They come in, they want a job, and you look at them and say, honey, son, you're not prepared. You know, that is, and they don't realize they've been cheated. Cheated. That's the word the three of us use for 12 years.
The other part to that is, you know, we have people coming from other countries country for an education.
Can we do that?
And we have corporations who are paying thousands upon thousands of dollars for these international students to work for them.
That's right.
And we give them visas. And, you know, even after we give them an H-1B visa, we sponsor them and pay for their permanent green card. And their families get, you know, green cards based on these companies sponsoring them. And it's not that there aren't opportunities. There's a whole other element, and it's that we lack knowledge of what career exploration and what opportunities are there. How do you get into these roles? And so it is about education, because we're paying for people to come here and do these jobs. I mean, we are paying. I have had several candidates that we've paid. And not only are we paying for them to work for us, we are paying them six-figure salaries. They are starting off. I have had candidates from other countries turn down $100,000 jobs because somebody else offered them more money. So the jobs are here. We are not prepared for this. So when I hear the statement that education isn't for everyone, it's like, no, it is. We're being left behind because we have that mentality, and that mentality needs to stop.
I want to ask you a question. Let me just break in. So this is a question that we ask a 12th grade, a senior class. These are basically 11th and 12th graders we asked a couple years ago. And we asked them. See, young people, they have the answers when they don't have the answers, right? And I've used this a lot. I asked them as we were sitting in this classroom, you know, what skills do you think a person should leave the 12th grade with? And this is what they said. Counseling about future options, knowledge and comprehension about the real world, proper communication. They should know about themselves and the world. They should be able to write well, read well, speak well, have a goal, a sense of accomplishment, know about history and world history. They should know math and science. They should be able to speak another language. They should know have social skills, how to interact with others. They should have computer skills. They should have common sense. They said that. And they should be have knowledge about financial literacy. And then after that, and this is what they said. And then we turned and looked at them. Are you getting that here at this school? And unequivocally, they all said, no.
But the other thing that's sad about that is not only did they say they were not getting that information at the school site, there was a reluctance to get that information from those, which was us, who was willing to give them that information. So there is a level of learning that's stuck in too many young people today. Well, I haven't got it, and, you know, and so let me just get out of here instead of let me get what I need so I can do what I, you know, to have that job that's really going to pay well. Dee, I'm going to ask you to stay on the line before you, because Brianna's going to get some information from you. We want your information, because I'm going to be contacting you about coming and talking to our young people. Would that be okay?
I would love to do that. I just left this tech inclusion conference yesterday, and they were talking about all these tech opportunities for people of color and how do we steer people of color into tech. We're in Silicon Valley.
Wow.
Why aren't there any people of color?
You're going to be hearing from me pretty quick.
We're going to do a tech show very soon on something we've never done before. But just thank you for calling and putting a sense of what they call the real world into this, because that's what I hear from young people all the time. By the way, when we asked them, was that what they were getting out of this school? They said, hell no. But they didn't know they were being cheated. Wanted the easy way out, and here we were. And they were calling, man, you hard on this, Doug Marshall.
And they weren't available for the other, for what they really wanted. So, Dee, I'm going to ask that you stay on the line. Brianna's going to pick you up and get some information from you, and I'm going to be contacting you. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you for your call. Hang on. Great. All right.
So I'm going to say that was wonderful.
That said it all for us, right? I mean, really. Go ahead.
Yeah, my grandson started kindergarten this year, and he went into kindergarten reading. My 4-year-old grandson reads. I write them letters, and they read my handwritten letters to me. So they're in school reading. They know their letters, of course, if they're reading numbers, alphabet. They can recognize the sequencing and all the things that you learn in first grade, my grandkids already know. And so I said to my daughter, don't stop teaching your kids. Mm. Just because Drew is in kindergarten, don't leave the teaching up to the teacher. Because once they get in school, there's this, okay, he's in school now. No. Your job hasn't stopped school has started.
I like that.
Your job must continue so that he continues to love to learn. And she was like, oh, yeah, well, yeah, that does make sense. So kids come into kindergarten unprepared, where they don't know how to write, they don't know how to spell their names, they don't recognize the letters. They don't know. They can't count past 10. It is not the teacher's job to do all of that. The first teacher is at home. And if you want your child to succeed in anything, sit down with them regularly and spend some learning time with them so they can feel good about being good. That is just so important.
Well, the complete circle is really is between the school, the student, the parent, and the teacher, right? All three. And the more people that are involved in that process all the way through.
Especially making sure that those parents, those teachers, are on the same accord as the parents. Because that shouldn't stop when you get 15. When you get to high school, you know, it doesn't matter if there are 7 teachers. All of them will be hearing what I've got to say and what my expectations are from them for my child. You know, it's not over. When they get to that 15 number, it's not over yet. In college, they should still be able to call you too. So education, that is fundamental. That learning and then making sure they've got what they need to get the best they can out of it is critical.
You know, we haven't done the horror stories that we've seen purposely. I mean, we've seen some horror stories. We've left out the 3 of us. Because if you did, you might never send your kid to a school. You want to say some mistake?
Yeah, there's a couple of things that come to my mind as we're going through this. And I'll go back a little bit to say that when parents have their own idea of what their educational experiences was, then that helps them form how they're going to work with their child and how they see education for their child. And so if you have been defeated by the education mm-hmm. system, mm-hmm. then you're not looking at it as an aid to your child. You're looking at it strictly as my kid's got to go to school. And so when you get a phone call from school, you don't want to hear it because you remember all the stuff phone calls that were made about you and right. all this kind of stuff.
Right.
And it becomes this confrontational
right.
situation and relationship.
Right.
And so it's not necessarily even about what's good for the kid. It's about my experiences.
Exactly.
Forget that school. I'm not trying to. All I want to know is what that report card say. And then even then, like you said, Doc, it's about the end game, which is the graduation.
Right.
Long as you graduate, I did what I was supposed to do.
Exactly.
That's how it's summed up, and that's kind of the thought that goes along with that on a whole. So and keep in mind now, things are different because grandmother isn't the grandmother who used to be there. Grandfather isn't the grandfather. Parents aren't the same. So a lot of parents, if they've gotten out of school, they're still like maybe what, 10, 12, 15 years older than their own child?
And Dre, let's just throw this one in too. A lot of parents send their kids to school now, not to learn, but to get them out the house away mm-hmm. from them.
Yeah,
okay?
Yeah. You know, I got some free childcare now. But cycling back to the point that was being made about how the students recognize these are the things we're supposed to have, but resistant to somebody coming in, because for the most part, for that 12 years that they've been going to school, the system beat them.
Yeah.
The system beat them. For whatever reason, and there's a lot of things we can say, but the system has arbitrarily taken them out of the process of getting their own education and got them to a point to where the end game is the graduation. Not picking up the information that they need so that they can move on and do whatever it is. Right. If you don't want to go to college, you still got to read. If you don't want to go to college, you still got to balance your checkbook. If you don't want to go to college, you still got to fill out a job application. If you don't have those skills developed, when you walk out that door and down those steps, what am I going to do now? But they're somehow programmed to believe that through osmosis, success is just going to pop up and happen, rather than even learning a character trait called putting in the work.
You know, and this, you know, we're going to move on, but I got to say, look, you're not, we're educators, okay? We do a lot of things, but I guess maybe the greatest forte is education, you know, Alive and Free, Lady Estelle, Mr. Akins, myself. You can call us about this at any time, 800-765-3437. You hit us up on our website. That's something we are, I believe, experts on. And let me give a real quick shout out. You talk about homeschooling your child?
Yeah.
All right, I want to give a shout out to a couple of parents, Drs. Chris and Neka Harrison, who homeschooled their children. Their son, they had a vision. Their son just got a full scholarship. Full scholarship. Scored in the 95th percentile on the, not the SAT. What's the other one? The other
ACT.
SAT. The ACT. They had a vision. Not only did he get rewarded with college acceptance, that young man in Gozen Harrison got a full scholarship to college just because of the vision they had for their young person.
And isn't he like 16?
16. He's 16 years old.
That's crazy.
Yeah, but it's
true. You know what? Real quick, remember, little kids in college was a norm back in the day.
Dr. King was 15.
Yeah, you could. It was easy to find a 15 or 16 year old on a college campus. Now, when one happens, we're ready for the World Book of Records or something because it's so unusual now. But the potential is still there.
I can't cut him off.
You got it.
All right. The topic tonight is all about school. Learning and education is fundamental. But first, we heard from Landon Dickey, a young man working for San Francisco School District, announcing an event coming this Saturday at Mission High School from 9:30 to 3, Black Family Day, where opportunities for college admission is available for you, including scholarships, workshops, and breakfast too. But socially, emotionally, whatever the case may be, education should be taken seriously. Feeling safe, like you belong, where learning can take place, surrounded by adults who care and work to create that space, where kids feel good about being good and allowed to develop the way they should, building character self-discovery, finding what you can do, then connect with a mentor who can guide and support you. Classrooms with structure, parents who care, and teachers with presence, purpose, and high standards. But you've got to be willing to follow the rules, bringing your best self, your A game, not to be or act a fool. So raise your own standards. Be the best you can be. Get the most you can out of school. And please, stay alive and free. This is Lady Estelle asking you to consider this.
Thank all of you for calling in. Hope we gave you something to think about. All you young people are in school. Get up tomorrow. Be there on time. And I'm saying, have a great and productive year. Rob, we'll see you next week right here, live and free radio, Street Soldiers. Good night.
Tell me what you see when you look at me. Do you see another brother lost in these streets looking for his soul?
Trying to find my soul.
Or do you see another brother searching for lost souls in these streets? A street soldier.
Street soldier.
Here to help you get that chip off your shoulder, warm your colder days and sober your drunken ways, and find a way to help you get over these hurdles placed in our path. Yeah. And this is not meant to amuse you.